This is Reach Beyond Australia. Our programs on this frequency will commence shortly. This is Reach Beyond Australia. Our programs on this frequency will commence shortly. This is Reach Beyond Australia. Our programs on this frequency will commence shortly. Reach Beyond Australia. Our programs on this frequency will commence shortly. This is Reach Beyond Australia. Our programs on this frequency will commence shortly.
Reach Beyond Australia welcomes you to this Japanese language broadcast.
こちらはHCJB の日本語放送です。この時間はオーストラリア北西部のクノノラ送信所から日本語番組をお届けしています。週末土曜日と日曜日は 朝と夜のこの時間に日本語番組を30分間お届けしています。放送時間と周波数は朝7時半からは 15.410MHz、 そして夜の再放送の周波数は 11.905MHz です。こちらは HCJB の日本語放送です。皆さんいかがお過ごしでしょうか。尾崎和夫です。今年も2月27日から3日間アメリカのペンシルバニア州で恒例のウィンター SWL フェストが開催されました。日本短波クラブからは理事の大竹俊光さんが出席され、会場でお会いされた方々にインタビューしてくださいました。今日もその中から2人の方をご紹介ください。
このフェストのオーガナイザーをやっておられますジョン・
フィグリオシ。
フィグリオシ。あの最初にちょっと自己紹介して、セルフイントロダクション。
I came to shortwave radio as a teenager, like many people did. My father built a Heathkit GR54 for me when he saw that I had an interest in radio. And that's how I began I became a member of the North American Shortwave Association, NASWA, as a 13-year-old initially. And like a lot of people, I got very much involved in it, collected QSL cards, was really into it. The thing that I remember most from it was the invasion of Czechoslovakia by the Soviet Union in 1968, and I heard a lot of that on the radio, Free Radio Prague, and how the different stations reacted to it, Radio Moscow. So I really got interested in it. But then, of course, I went to college, and I kind of pulled away a little bit from the radio then. And then after I got out of college, and a few years later, after I got married and started having children, I got interested in the radio again, so.
彼自身やっぱりティーンエイジャーの時に父親が買ってくれたヒースキットですね、これで短波に興味を持ちまして、
yes.
その頃からいろんな曲を聴いて、レポートを書くというようなことで、このナスワに入会したのは13歳の時だということで、ずいぶん長い間関係しているということです。 So, what is the current role of yourself in the NASWA?
Currently I'm on the executive council at NASWA.
彼も理事会のメンバーの一人でして、実際にこの毎月の開始に、ショートビセンターというコラムを設けていろいろ書いておるということです。で、一番我々にとって重要なのは彼がこのウィンター SW フェストのオーガナイザーの一人だということで、いろいろご苦労されているわけ。How many years for the fest?
This is the 33rd fest. So we've been going 33 years. Richard and I have been chairing it for the last 20 years.
フェストそれ自体は今年33回目ですけれども、そのうちの20回はリチャード・カフさんと一緒に準備をし、会の実行にいろいろ携わっているということです。Any special comments on this year's fest?
Well, I mean, over the years, the fest has changed. It was originally just shortwave radio. Mm-hmm. And now we like to say that it covers radio in all of its different dimensions. So we have seen many changes, but it always is centered around radio in the final analysis.
フェスト自体は最初は短波放送だけの集まりだったんですけれども、徐々にラジオ関係のすべてを網羅するということで、今年の話題も非常に広範なラジオ関係の話題を取り上げるということで来ております。 How many US participants this year? students?
This year, about 100.
Uh-huh.
About 100. We've had as many in past years as 150. But over the years now, it's sort of settled in around 100.
今年も約100名の出席があるということで、like the same、ここ数年はだいたい100名程度の参加があると。で、以前はピークの時代には150名ぐらい集まった時もあるそうですけれども、まあ、最近はだいたい100名近くという数に落ち着いているということです。What is the major hardship or problem to organize this large activity?
Well, I think it's dealing with the hotel as the because every year that the hotel's contracts and conditions change a little bit, so we have to make sure that we meet certain benchmarks like the number of hotel rooms in order to be able to get some benefits from the hotel so that we can afford to put on the program at a fee that is affordable for as many people as possible. That's the biggest challenge.
やっぱり三泊程度のあれになります。行事になりますんで、ホテルの前一応決まってるわけですけれども、どの期間に何十室かの部屋を確保して、それから会議室、宴会場ですね、こういうものを確保するか、その辺の準備がやっぱり、オーガナイザーとして一番頭が痛いところで苦労しておるということです。Anyway, that the all 100 participants enjoys every year.
They do, and then it's sort of, there's always a few new people, but many people come back. It's sort of a reunion every year.
Right.
Friends, we all become friends. Everybody contributes something. Some people volunteer to do certain things. Some people present very good forum sessions in which they provide the knowledge that they have to the rest of the people that are here. People are very good about stepping up, which makes it a pleasure to put together for everyone.
One interesting topic is North Korea's inside. Did you hear that?
Yes, I did.
Do you have any sample?
Yes, we've had a gentleman from Australia who has come. Three of the last 4 years, or 4 or 5 years, and one of his principal interests was what you know, North Korea, and also the society of North Korea, how it has changed over time. So he's made some trips to North Korea. He has put together some scholarly articles about it, and he shared that with us here. So he came back this year because it had been 5 years since he had done his first program for us, and he updated that for us.
オーストラリアの方なんですけれども、時々北朝鮮に行かれまして、いろんな調査をされていて、特にラジオ関係の情報を集めておられてるんですけれども、5年前に一度このフェストで報告をされて、今年久しぶりにアップデートしてくれたということで、大変貴重な情報が得られたということです。Okay, so at the conclusion, you have any comment to the Japanese listeners?
Well, first of all, we're very happy to have Otake-san here with us many years now. And if you can make the trip to the United States, you would be most welcome if you wish to come to the Winter SWL Festival. You can get information at swlfest.com.
ということで、オーガナイザーのお一人に大変貴重な情報をいただきました。Thank you very much.
Thank you.
こんにち
は。
ちょっとバックグラウンドで音楽が聞こえると思いますけれども、このフェストのアクティビティの一つで、ショートウェーブ、シャイニング それのオープニングのミュージックセッションが行われていますので、ちょっとバックグラウンドで音楽が聞こえているかと思いますが、ジャン・ロビンソンさんのインタビューを続けます。 VOA のアクティビティのことを聞いて。 So about VOA.
Okay. So about 1981 or 82, I came into the newsroom with a lot of knowledge from shortwave listening. In other words, I knew every capital of every country, especially in Africa. Already knew this. I mean, some people in the newsroom didn't know these cities, these capitals. I had to look on a map. Well, I came in, my first job was with the Africa desk. By 1983 or so, they needed a replacement correspondent in Nairobi. And I was the choice for that. And I was, in fact, the youngest correspondent ever to be sent out. So I was, what was 1982. So I was quite young, so 25, and went to Nairobi for 3 years.
まあ、BCL をやっててお考えで、アフリカの国の名前、情報、それからイングリッシュとアフリカも担当してましたんで、すごくアフリカに詳しいということで、ニュースルームへ行ったら、ものすごいアフリカ通だということが分かりまして、ナイロビのグアイにということで、3年間行ったそうですけども、彼が VOA から行ったヤングストコレスポンデンツということになります。で、
Right, so perfect situation. A shortwave listener becomes a foreign correspondent. And I, of course, at the time we had the various Sony receivers. We had the SW1, SW100. And I used to travel with those. Ethiopia, Uganda, all these countries in that area. And I mean, I knew it was important to actually hear my reports. And the only way at the time, no internet, you could is to use the shortwave receiver. So in some of the places I used to go, like Ethiopia for the OAU meetings, used to hang the wire antennas down the window from the hotel. I wrote about this. Passport to World Band Radio had an article about this in the 80s. So it was the perfect melding connection of the hobby with professional interests. And so 86, I came back here. And then 1986, I started working actually again for English to Africa for a period of time. And, but again, even when I was hosting programs for English to Africa, like Nightline Africa and various other ones, people remembered me from when I was a reporter. So I used to get all these mail letters, doing that kind of thing.
まあ、彼が本当に趣味が生かされたといいますか、趣味によって外国の知識を知り、それから実際にアフリカに駐在していた時もエチオピアその他のいろんな国に出張に行ったわけですけれども、自分のレポートがどういうふうに VOA で流れているかというのを知るためにソニーのポータブルラジオを持って、ホテルからまたワイヤーを倒しまして、 VOA からの自分の報告がどういうふうに編集されて使われているかというようなことを確認して、実に趣味と仕事が絡み合って大変役に立ったという印象を持っているそうです。でワシントンに帰りましてからも知り合いがアフリカ各地におりますんで、メールを交換するというようなことで非常にいろんな情報が得られたということであります。
Yeah, so interesting story. I was doing the programs to Africa in 1986 through 1990 or so. I would insist on reading the frequencies on the air, not just the meter bands, but at the time I would insist on reading 19 meters, 17, 8, 95, 15 point whatever the frequency was. And the reason I did that was because it was important to help the listener specifically know.
Oh, you mean VOAs, for example?
Yeah, in Africa, the African listeners. So I did that for a number of years, and until 91 when I they sent me to Bangkok, and I spent 5 years there. In Thailand.
Oh, Bangkok.
As a Southeast Asian tourist. So I covered that whole region. But again, with the shortwave receivers, I used to, at that point, was the SW100, and used to, you know, record. So I actually have a collection of many of my reports that I recorded.
で彼はのバンコクにも5年間いたそうですけども、いつもタンパラジオと付き合いながら情報を集めていたというです。で実は彼はもうその後大変なラジオコレクターになりましてものすごいラジオのコレクションがいた。Please tell me your radio collection stories.
Oh, collection radio? Well, you see upstairs, there are a few of them here. I mean, right now, let's see, I have a long list of radios, so I keep this list, and right now, about 70 or 80, you know, of these. Let's see if I can get it here. Yeah, there's the list. As you can see,
JRC.
So you can see many JRC, yeah. Watkins Johnson, mm-hmm. Tentec, Telefunken, Scanty, Anritsu.
Oh, yeah, 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 that's professional.
Yes, so, and Drake and the others. So, you know, I enjoy bringing them here. Mm. I continue working for VOA, obviously. 96 came back, covered Capitol Hill, mm-hmm. then the White House, mm-hmm. and before I retired in 2014, mm-hmm. also head of the Burmese Myanmar service for almost 5 years. Mm-hmm. So, but again, the fact that I, you know, I was continuing to listen to shortwave broadcasts was an enormous help to me professionally, both as a correspondent and heading this language service. And I remember the days when we used to listen to those beautiful interval signals from NHK, especially when the broadcast came right from Japan. Mm-hmm. And that was one of my favorite stations. And so, you know, throughout this long period of my life, I mean, it was, as I said last year, at these SWL Fest, a constant companion, shortwave for all these people here, a constant companion. And for me, still, even though I'm not working professionally, and even though the number of stations have gone down, it continues to be a constant companion for me in memories, and also, you know, what still is on the air. You know, so it really has been a friend to me for so many years.
Yeah. ワシントンに帰りましても、キャピトルヒル議会、それはあるいはホワイトハウス、この辺の担当もされましたし、バーミーズセクションのチーフもやったということで、仕事的にもいろいろエキサイティングな仕事をしたと。でこのフェストにつきましても毎年いろんな人に会うことでもう趣味とは切っても切れない。そういうことで、受信機のコレクションもいろいろ始まりまして、現在、70数台の受信機を持っておりまして、彼は日本のヤオフクのオークションですね、これを注目しておりまして、出物があると早速対応して買うというようなことで、先ほどのリストにはアンリスのプロ用の受信機も載っておりましたけれども。 Currently, what is the most expensive radio you have?
Right now, the most expensive one for me are two German radios, mm-hmm. the AEG 1830/3 and the Rode & Schwarz EK85, both of which I've had here at the fest. Mm-hmm. You know, and they, the value of those in the $2,000 or $3,000 range. Mm-hmm. But just recently, I took these Anritsu Anritsu, these two Anritsu receivers, and they came from Japan. One of them came from Japan. As we speak now, one of them is still coming, the RG53A. And these are just beautiful instruments. I mean, and what's interesting to me is the fact that, like, through the Japan auction site, it's a connection into the user and collector world in Japan. And what struck me is how well taken care of a lot of this equipment was by Japanese users.
まあ、あの彼が持っているもので一番高いのはやっぱり、ドイツ製のかなり古い2台なんですけども、最近、まあ、アンリツのプロ用の受信機が手に入って日本から届いたんですけど、とにかくものすごく手入れされていて、もうそれだけで、感激したということであります。 So also 75 receivers that you have to take care of by yourself.
Yeah, it's a little crazy insanity, right? I mean, right, we joke about it, but we, in a way, we're all a little crazy because we love each one. I mean, for me, each one is like a person. You have to get to know how to treat it well and how to help it help you, because each one has different controls and tools. You know, I joke with people. I say we, you know, each one is like a personality, you know, whether it's Drake or JRC or Rizzo or, you know, Collins or all these things. But I wanted to go back to the VOA connection again, because VOA allowed me to visit and travel to countries that as a child I dreamed of through the radio station. So, you know, when I visited the Soviet Union, I was able to visit Radio Moscow, Radio Kiev, and when I was a professional, I visited, you know, East Timor, which was a rare station for us, you know.
Yeah. まあ、ちょっと先ほどのラジオのコレクションの方に戻りますけども、それぞれのメーカーにやっぱり設計者の思想というものを感じられるし、自分のところに届いた受信機見ても、まあ、使われていた方の気持ちといいますか、そういうものが伺われますので、もう本当に70数台それぞれにいろんな気持ちが伝わるというふうに思っています。ではまた VOA の話に戻りますけれども、やっぱり子どもの時短波を聞いていて、ああこういう国に行けたらいいなと夢にも思っていたような国に、まあ、コレスポンデントとして訪問できたし、あるいは VOA のチームとして、ソ連邦その他のいろんな珍しい国に行けるということで、まあ、いろんなプロとしても子どもの夢が叶えられたというふうに思って、大変グッドライフをプロフェッショナルにもホビーの上でもされていたという感じだと思います。Any conclusion that?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's really a very special group, but it's not only here in the United States. I mean, persons like yourself and others in Europe and Asia who really love this this pastime, like Victor Gunita in Sri Lanka, and some of the great Japanese DXers, and the ones in Europe and Finland. And we all share this interest, that we had this intensity of interest in listening to these voices that existed for so many years. And even though so many of them are gone now, that spark is still living inside of us.
まあ、このフェストをやっていて、毎年いろんな方が参加されるわけですけれども、ヨーロッパからもいらっしゃるし、スリランカのビクターも何度か来ておられまして、お互いにそれぞれの、まあ、熱意を発揮しながらこのフェストが続けられているということは大変嬉しく思っております。So any conclusion?
Yeah, well, thanks for traveling as far as you did to come to these places, and you know, you can see that we're still so enthusiastic about this, and in the next room here you can hear in the background these sounds are being played as part of this gathering every year. We don't know how long this will continue, but the fact that the number of people still come to this to kind of share in this joy of the medium of radio and the memories we have. It's important, you know.
Yeah. まあ、あのフェストにそれぞれの方が、まあ、熱意を分け合いながらといいますかということで、続いてまいりましたので、これから何年このような元気が続くか分かりませんけれども、お互いに、こういう機会を大事にしていきたいというふうに思っているということです。
So there's one more story I have, which is when I was a correspondent, I went to Osaka to cover APEC back in 1994 or 5, something like that. And I went to the electronics section in Osaka, and I saw in one of those shops a Kobayashi receiver. Okay. And this is like the holy grail of receivers for many people, certainly in Japan. So just in the last few weeks, one of these appeared in that auction site, and it was way over my price level. Finally sold for 12,000 US. But it was such a thing of beauty. It just had the LED readout plus the mechanical dials. And if, you know, again, it was too expensive for me. But so I had to let that whole grail go.
あの彼は、まあ、APEC で大阪の取材にも行ったそうですけれども、その機会にやはり電気街に行きまして、いろいろ日本の、受信機が並んでいるのを見て、その中で夢にまで見た小林の受信機というのがあったんですが、それが最近オークションに出たんですけれども、とても自分の予算では買えないような値段がついておって、残念ながら諦めたそうですけれども、いずれにしてもそう、ジャパニーズエレクトロニクス、very good day.
Excellent. I mean, the Japan Radio Company and Anritsu, and I mean, so even today, it's for me, it's a way to hold on to into those memories, you know. Yeah.
ということで、あの日本の電機メーカーの全盛期時代の名機を彼は揃えて、そのそれぞれの機器の設計者の心意気、使った方のお気持ち、そういうものを組みながら、70数台の受信機を愛しているそうです。Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I hope we can see you again here. Yeah.
今年も2月の27日から3日間、アメリカのペンシルバニア州で恒例のウィンター SWL フェストが開かれました。日本からは日本短波クラブ理事の大竹俊道さんが出席されました。そして大竹さんには会場でお会いされた方々にインタビューしていただきましたので、その雰囲気が皆様にもよく伝わったことと思います。大竹さん、どうもご苦労様でした。さて、来週のこの時間はアリゾナに住んで25年の小畑伊代子さんに、その生活体験を綴ったサボテン日記を覗かせてもらいます。さあ、どうぞお楽しみに。お聞きの放送はHCJB の日本語放送です。週末土曜日と日曜日は朝と夜のこの時間に日本語番組を30分間お届けしています。放送時間と周波数は朝7時半からは 15.410MHz、 そして夜の再放送の周波数は 11.905MHz です。どうか皆様の地方の受信状況、また番組に対するご意見ご希望などをお聞かせください。受信確認書ベリカードは毎月新しいデザインでお届けしています。でお便りの宛先は郵便番号169-0073、東京都新宿区百人町1-17-8、ヨドバシ協会 HCJB 係です。なお、 E メールでレポートをくださる方は hcjbjapan.office@ @gmail.com です。皆様からのお便りをお待ちしております。これでこの時間の番組を終わります。皆様一人一人の上に神様からの豊かな恵みと祝福をお祈りしながらお別れいたします。それでは次の放送まで、どうぞごきげんよう。さようなら。
Thank you for tuning to Reach Beyond Australia.